Hi, I'm State Representative Jonathan Brostoff, and I'm here with Ebrio, who joins us in the state capitol. And we just kind of wanted to share your story a little bit and tell people what you're doing here and how you came to be active in politics yourself. So do you want to just tell the folks a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, so my name is Abril Moreno, and I represent Madison, Voces de la Frontera chapter. I started with Voces de la Frontera in September, and you know the way I got involved was through, you know, my family was going through a hard process, and we didn't know where to go, who to go to that would work on this kind of issues that Voces works on, and so my uncle was lost on the border for 3 months, maybe 2 years ago, and you know we didn't know where to go. You know, my family was desperate. You know, we wanted help, we wanted someone that could find my uncle, and so that's when Voces came in. You know, we had a friend, a family friend, and you know, they mentioned Voces de la Frontera to us, and so we went to Milwaukee, all the way from Sheboygan, to tell them, you know, the case that we were going through as a family, from, you know, having that immigrant member that was crossing the border, and so, you know, crossing the border is not easy. Yeah, it's also something that's difficult, something that, you know, it's painful to have to do that to come to this country. And so Voces was able to find my uncle, but he didn't make it. You know, he was there for 3 months and he passed away in the border close to Arizona. And so that, when all of that happened, you know, it made me realize that, you know, we wanted to help, my family wanted to help, our community, know that Voces existed as an organization that could help, you know, cases like this, and in other areas of immigration. You know, we are known for the advocacy that we do as an organization, and so that's kind of how I got involved, you know, and every time that I do a case and work for Voces in my office, you know, something, you know, that I have to go similar to what my uncle did in other cases, you know, that's why I'm there for, you know, because everything that my uncle did and everything that happened, you know, that's what makes me be passionate about helping my community.
And how did you come to get to Wisconsin? What's your story?
So I was 4 when I crossed the border with my mother. You know, I was little and I was able to cross the border with my mother along with my sister, and my dad was already in this country before us, and so we were able to raise money from what my dad sent to us in Mexico to be able to come to this country. And so when I was 4, you know, I was able to, you know, get trained through a lady that crossed kids and children, and so, you know, we would have to work with, you know, learning another identity of another child. It wasn't just a stranger, you know, that was from this country. It was the grandkids of the lady that, you know, trained us to come to this country. And so that's really how I was able to cross over here. You know, I had to learn a kid's identity, learn their name. Sometimes we even have to change our color of hair. And so, you know, and she would, like, try to fit us the best that we could to the picture of the grandkids. You know, to match it up with them, and so, you know, it took a couple of days to be able to learn that, you know, and it wasn't a nice process. You know, this lady, you know, would barely feed us. We didn't have beds. You know, we would only had a blanket in those rooms, and so that is, you know, it's hard to go through it, and
yeah, that. That's, I think, an important story to tell. And when you, and then, so you came to Wisconsin, you went to Sheboygan?
Yeah, we arrived, when we crossed, we arrived through California, through the border, mm-hmm. and we had only one uncle in Sheboygan, so he was the one that picked us up all the way to California, and that's how we made it to Sheboygan.
And then you got involved, you went to school, got involved in history and all the other kind of passions you have for academics, and then, and you got really good at soccer. And sports.
I did.
And you played some professional soccer for a little bit.
Yeah.
And now you're graduating from high school and you're working to help other people who are going through situations like yourself, but you're also, as a DACA recipient, in a pretty tough situation now, right?
Yeah, definitely. The way I was able to become a DACA recipient was through high school. And I was going through a difficult process where I wanted to apply to college, and I couldn't apply to college because of the fact that I didn't have Social Security. So that's when my parents, you know, said, hey, Abril, you know, we know that we barely remember, you know, what you had to go through while crossing the border. And so, you know, they gave me that talk that I was an immigrant child, and whether I was here or in a different place, you know, I don't have the privilege like other kids do here. And so not having the Social Security is what got us to learn about DACA and the ability that came in with DACA. And so since then I've been a DACA recipient, and it's been a really great opportunity. You know, it gave us the ability to have a driver license, a work permit, and be able to get involved in college. So that has been, you know, an open gate to me as well as for other DACA recipients. But what with everything that's going on now, it's upsetting because there was a purpose why DACA was passed, because we were young kids. Yeah. You know, I was 4 at the time that I crossed. And so that, there was a big purpose on why DACA was, you know, created, and it, for it to be repealed. It's really upsetting, and it's really difficult situation for us. You know, we're thinking about dropping out from college. You know, what do we do? Being stuck in a job for our lives. You know, so it's difficult.
Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, it's and you know, you're doing everything right. You filled the paperwork. You told the government your situation. The government said, okay, we're gonna figure out a path. And now, you know, it's just kind of all been shredded for some cheap political points. But what would you tell to those representatives or senators or community members who are keen on taking your DACA away and ending DACA? What's your message to them?
I think my message is, you know, we were young, and it's not like it was a opportunity for everyone. Mm-hmm. You know, it was only for those kids that crossed, not knowing what we were doing. You know, if it was illegal, if we were going to be immigrants, you know, it was a big purpose, you know, why President Obama was able to pass that. So I think that really to reflect on why the repealment on DACA, you know, I think it's hard to come up with a solution of citizenship, a pathway to residency, but really we're here because our parents sacrificed their lives, you know, to bring us here. And I think we deserve that opportunity to continue our dreams and, you know, becoming lawyers, becoming doctors, teachers, you know. I think really that's what we want. You know, we want to have a future here. We're not here to take your jobs or anything else, you know, but to be able to have that dream, you know. And that's why we're called dreamers, because we have that dream on becoming someone, you know, having a career, having a better life. So I think really reflecting on why DACA was able to pass, you know, with President Obama. But, you know, this year has been difficult, and it's been really hard, you know, to continue to think what it's going to happen next.
And while you're here in Madison, the reason for our initial meeting was you're organizing an event with some other folks who are going to be coming tomorrow, right? Which will be the 22nd. Can you give a little details about the event tomorrow?
Yeah. So tomorrow, for Voces de la Frontera, we wanted to do a press conference, and it's going to be at 10 a.m. At the Assembly Parlor, just for 30 minutes, press conference. And that press conference is AB 190 and SB 275, anti-immigrant bills that not only affect our community, but, you know, the entire city, and not just the immigrant community, but everyone in general. And so I think that the message with that is we don't want police and law enforcement to be ICE agents. You know, they were, you know, they have the capacity for what they have as a career as law enforcement. So I don't think they should add another job into their positions as law enforcement. And, you know, even us as community, as Latinos, you know, we call the cops for situations that we see that are bad in the community. And so bringing this kind of bills and law enforcement to be like ICE agents will decrease, you know, what we report. Absolutely. As Latinos and immigrants. So I think the message is, you know, we don't want ICE agents and anti-immigrant bills like AB 190 affect our entire community.
So again, tomorrow the 22nd, you can join Abil and Voces at 10 o'clock at the Assembly Parlor, right?
Yes.
And if you want to get in touch, we'll tag Voces' Facebook page so people can get that in the comments section. But yeah, I really appreciate you sharing your story, and I'm sorry you're going through this tough time, and I'm sorry that this is happening in our country right now. It's absolutely disgusting, but you know, I think there is a will out there for the majority of people in this country to do what's right on this, and I just think that there's got to be people watching this and other people who are sensitive to this, making sure they're letting their elected representatives, especially at the federal level, know exactly what your thoughts on this are, and that we want great history teachers. Like, Gabriel's going to be a great teacher. We need really good history teachers right now in Wisconsin, and we want people like her to thrive and succeed and keep playing soccer and all the other fun stuff you like doing and help making our community and our state better. And to do that, we need to make sure that we continue DACA and that we allow people who came here at a very young age to know well of their own the ability to thrive in our country. So thank you very much. And any last words?
No. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks.